ladies and gentlemen, he's a child of God, a husband, NRA conservative, radical right-wing supervillain, and Twitter rock star. American by birth, Texan by choice, and a badass by nature. He's the owner of TomOHalloran.com, OHalloranMedia.com, and PatriotRadio.net. Please welcome Tom O'Halloran.
There ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the U.S.
And God bless America. This is the Patriot Radio Show. I'm your host, Tom O'Halloran, and I'm broadcasting today from my underground bunker deep in Arcantana, Nebraska. I'm here to educate, irritate, and agitate. And folks, I guarantee you full 100% agitation by the time the show's over, or you get triple your money back at the door. Again, my name's Tom O'Halloran, my primary blog being TomOHalloran.com. When you get there, please follow me on Facebook, Twitter, Spreaker, any other social media that you fancy. Also, please follow my editor, Veronica Coffin. Veronica manages several websites on our network, and without her doing that, I couldn't do this. You'll find her follow button at the bottom of each and every post. You can find us on Facebook, facebook.com/Patriot Radio Show. And personally, I'm at facebook.com/O'Halloran. If you'd like to be a part of the conversation today, our studio line is open. Our number is 832-761-1766. With all the political stuff going on, we're joined by our good friend Ken Crow several times a week now, so the studio line isn't open that often. Today it is open. It's 832-761-1766. And I am on air 5 days a week. So if you haven't been listening 5 times a week, you're slacking off. Please tune in every Monday through Thursday, 9 a.m. Texas time, for this, the Patriot Radio Show. On Fridays, same bat time, same bat channel, I do Jihad on America, where I talk about the Islamists in America. I tell you who they are, what they want, and why you should be afraid. If you did not catch my show on the Muslim Brotherhood, my show, Islam is Not a Religion, or my show on Islamophobia, then please find your way to PatriotRadioShow.com. Listen to all three of these shows. They will give you insight and perspective on the Islamic topic that you've probably not heard elsewhere. They'll also give you a solid foundation upon which we build each and every Friday as we continue pulling back the mask of Islam, looking at what's being done in the name of Allah, both here and abroad. And I do the news about Islam around the world because it's a glimpse into the future of what's in store for us here in America if we continue to allow the cancer of Islam to spread here in the homeland. Keep abreast of my shows, listen to the live stream, as well as catch up on any of the archived shows that you may have missed, all at PatriotRadioShow.com. The show is also rebroadcast daily on conservativeradionetwork.com. And beginning this week, we're also being carried on Liberty Works Radio Network. That's LWRN.net. You can also find us on your iPhone or Android. Go to the App Store. Download either the Spreaker app or the TuneIn app and just do a search for Patriot Radio Show. And with that, we'll get into the show. I'm going to start the show off with what is generally our Tuesday feature. But again, with Ken Crow coming on talking about the the debates and the primaries and stuff that does get bounced around a little bit. This is our police misconduct update. This is a very, very pro-law enforcement show because I myself and most of my listeners are very pro-law enforcement. But that's law and lawful enforcement. But anytime you have a couple hundred thousand people of any class, whether they're accountants, lawyers, police, or priests, when you put a couple hundred thousand people of any category together, you will have a percentage of them that are bad eggs. This has always been the case. But until recent years, there's been what's known as the blue wall, where the police will block any investigations. They wouldn't report on their partner's bad acts. Nowadays, with the internet, with the general citizenry having video cameras, with traffic cams and security cameras everywhere recording virtually everything, it's almost like we are the big brother. I hadn't thought about that way till just now. But yeah, we've always been afraid of big brother watching us, but now we are the government's big brother, and that is the way it should be, because they are there to work for us. But what I report on each week are current items in the news. Not all brand new breaking stories, but some stories are being updated. But we're reporting this not that these cops are bad. We're reporting, hey, look, these bad acts are being addressed. These police are being suspended. They're being investigated. They're being discharged. And sometimes they're being locked up. So now that we have an understanding of what this report actually is, we'll begin. Update, Gasconade County, Missouri, first reported in February of last year. A deputy was indicted on federal charges for sexually abusing four women and steering a 14-year-old girl into prostitution. May he live a long and sexually filled life in prison. Washington County, Oregon. A deputy was charged with sexual misconduct with a minor and with the enticement of a child. Of all the stories I do, I can deal with the cops that steal from drug dealers, cops that steal from the people by turning in overtime for work they didn't do, even for the cops that are beating on suspects that are handcuffed behind their backs. But I have zero tolerance for this sexual misconduct with a child. These guys are wearing uniforms. They should be above reproach. And I wish him nothing but the worst. Eufaula, Alabama. An officer was arrested and charged with a drug conspiracy. New York. A lieutenant and two officers were suspended after a DUI hit and run in a parking lot that resulted in crashing into a hair salon. It gets stupid after that. I'm going to open this one up now. It's a DUI hit and run in a parking lot that results in a crashing into a hair salon, but it just gets stupid from there. We'll look into that and talk more maybe after the break. Patterson, New Jersey. An officer was arrested for discharging his gun while off duty. He was charged with aggravated assault and other charges. Niagara County, New York. A deputy pled not guilty to reckless driving for a fatal crash with an SUV. Well, if it was not guilty to reckless driving, it must have been attempted murder, perhaps. Because you were obviously in a fatal crash with an SUV. Update, Lincoln County, Wisconsin, first reported May of last year. A deputy was sentenced to 5 years in prison for sexually assaulting a 15-year-old girl. Again. Cincinnati, Ohio. Why don't we hear the media getting all over this? The media was quick to jump on the priests in the Catholic Church attacking the children, sexually abusing the children. Why don't we see the media getting all over these police officers sexually assaulting children? Cincinnati, Ohio. A viral video shows a man record his own arrest for jaywalking. The department says the arrest was unlawful. The man claims harassment. After the viral video had gone viral, the man had a contempt of court charge added to the jaywalking account. The investigation is ongoing. Update, Montgomery, Alabama. First reported in on the 2nd. Okay, not much of an update. This just happened last week. An officer was arrested in the shooting death of Gregory Gunn, an unarmed 58-year-old man. Why do we keep shooting unarmed people? Stevenson, Alabama. The chief was indicted for federal civil rights violations for assaulting as a suspect and failing to stop an unreasonable use of force by another officer. For assaulting, civil rights violations for assaulting as a suspect and failing to stop an unreasonable use of force. That doesn't even read right on the report. Update, Cleveland, Ohio, first reported March of last year. A court upheld the reinstatement of an officer who was fired for sending thousands of sexually explicit texts to female crime victims. Why does he get reinstated? He's sending lewd texts to crime victims, to female crime victims. Okay, this is getting opened up. We may talk about this one after the break as well. Maricopa County, Arizona, a deputy was suspended for 80 hours for having sexual contact with three female crime victims. He expected to retire soon and collect his pension. Why 80 hours? Again, these guys, it sounds like in many cases, they're getting a slap on the wrist. 80-hour suspension for having sexual contact with three crime victims. Tangipahoa Parish, Louisiana. Two deputies who also served as DEA task force members were arrested for drug distribution in a state police sting. Well, you're stupid. Here's your sign. McLean County, Illinois. A deputy was sentenced to 4 years imprisonment, ordered to pay restitution for stealing roughly $200,000 from the deputy's union, where he served as a treasurer. You're a treasurer and you think you're going to get away with stealing $200,000? DeKalb County, Georgia, now former sergeant, was sentenced to 2 years in prison for ordering the beating of three teens. Two deputies previously pled guilty to lesser sentences in exchange for their testimony against the sergeant. Ordering the beating of three teens. Again, only 2 years in prison. If you actually beat children, you go to prison for more than that. And here's a cop ordering the beating of three teens. I'm going to be looking into a lot of this stuff during the break. Usually there's one story. This time I've got three stories I've already opened. Woodbridge Township, New Jersey. Two officers were charged with tampering and false swearing over to cover an automobile wreck of a third officer. We see this almost every week. Carrollton, Missouri, an officer resigned amid sexual misconduct allegations. The investigation is ongoing. St. Paul, Minnesota, a sergeant cases are being reviewed after a massive sex trafficking case falls apart after an appeals court overturned three convictions. According to the report, the whole case against the accused, nine of them who have been tried and another 16 were awaiting trial, may be fictitious. Mesa, Arizona, an officer charged was an officer was charged with second-degree murder for the fatal shooting of Daniel Shaver, Borger, Texas. An officer was charged with assaulting a family member and committing. Or was it charged with assaulting a family member and fired? Montgomery County, Tennessee, an officer was arrested and charged with stalking for harassing and tracking a woman after he received a no-contact order from the court. Yeah, we see a number of these bad guys going into stalking mode, using the police databases to find out where they're at. Harris County, Georgia, a deputy who's been fired. He pulled over a female motorist, turned off his camera, and received oral sex. He has admitted to all of this, but said the act was consensual, whereas the driver said it was not. Oneida Nation, New York, an officer pled guilty to harassment for pulling a gun in a bar. San Antonio, Texas, an officer was suspended pending termination for fatally shooting Antoinette Scott, an unarmed motorist. Columbus County, North Carolina, a detective was arrested after his sting caught her selling opioids throughout the county. She was fired. Warren, Michigan, a lieutenant was charged with disorderly conduct and possessing a weapon while intoxicated for obstructing an investigation. Ward County, North Dakota, their sheriff and a captain were charged by a state's attorney for Dustin Irwin's in custody death. That, I believe, is the fourth charge for unjust killing by officers this week. I'm not sure what's going on there. Could be a coincidence, but again, maybe it's not. Folks, stick with us. We've got a lot more coming up after the break, but we do have some bills to pay, and it looks like I've got some reading to do as well. Shout out to everybody in the chat room, all the regulars, or at least some of the regulars, Catherine, Richard, Muriel. I appreciate you all more than you can know.
Tom O'Halloran, holding the line against tyranny from Washington, D.C.
I am America, one voice, united we stand. I am America, one hope to heal our land. There is still work that must be done. I will not rest until we
are back. This is the Patriot Radio Show, and I am your host, Tom O'Halloran. Before the break, we were doing our police misconduct update. Now, one of the stories, a New York Police Department lieutenant and two other cops were suspended without pay after their allegedly boozy crash into a Staten Island hair salon. Yeah, it does get stupid after that. I'll read you the article. This out of the New York Daily News. A New York NYPD lieutenant and two detectives were suspended without pay after the cops slammed into two cars and then a hair salon on Staten Island. The party's over for newly promoted police lieutenant and two NYPD colleagues suspended after a celebratory night out ended with a boozy hit and run in Staten Island. The trio were shelved without pay after Detective Christopher Carulla sideswiped another car and plowed into the Hair Do or Die salon as the off-duty cops were leaving Rookie's Sports Bar on Friday night. It gets stupid after that, one NYPD source said. Lieutenant Vincent Morelli, celebrating his promotion and raise, and Detective Frank Muirhead then loaded Carulla into another vehicle with Muirhead behind the wheel. They zipped away from the wreck, leaving Carulla's vehicle behind. The damaged vehicle in the parking lot belonged to the DJ at the Arthur Hill Road Bar, where the three cops stopped for drinks after dinner at a nearby restaurant. The DJ chased the panicked cops in his banged-up car, catching the three officers at a nearby red light. The men identified themselves as cops, said that one of them may have food poisoning, and they asked if they could come back Saturday morning to settle up. The DJ agreed. The accident wasn't reported until Saturday morning, after hours after the 9 p.m. crash. They were this drunk at 9 p.m.? What a bunch of candy asses. Well, I'd be more ashamed of that than I would be of getting caught for drunk driving. You're that drunk by 9 p.m.? Jeez. There were no injuries, and sources indicated that criminal charges were unlikely. Unlikely? Carulla claimed that he accidentally put the car in reverse, bouncing off the DJ's vehicle before lurching forward and smashing into the storefront. The car backed all the way in. The hair salon is destroyed. Something like $80,000 in damages. Let's see. One story was the guy got reinstated for sending all these sexual text messages to a crime victim, and he was just reinstated by order of a court. No explanation of why that's acceptable behavior, and no explanation either of why this one cop just got 2 years in prison for ordering two other officers to beat a handcuffed teenager, and three handcuffed teenagers. They're already handcuffed, so suspects in a burglary. And you only get 2 years in jail for that. Mind-boggling. While we're on the subject of police misconduct, let's talk about laVoy Finicum. I'm seeing Brother Richard wake up in the chat room. In the Oregon standoff last month, or was it 2 months ago now? I believe it was at the end of January. The standoff where laVoy Finicum was shot getting out of his car. It was said by the FBI that they were waiting for him to get out of his car, and when he got out of his car, he charged at them, and he was shot and killed for this. Now, I remained clear of the story because I was of the belief that when you take what is considered government property, never mind the fact that the BLM has no right to own land in Oregon or any other state, it was supposedly their property. These guys took it, had a standoff for several weeks. laVoy had made a comment that they weren't going to take him alive. When you make these kinds of statements, it can only end one way. The only variables are how long will it take and how many people will be involved. I steered clear of the story also because the videotape was unclear. The first videotape, it was hard for me to determine the facts anyway. But yes, Muriel in the chat room saying laVoy was murdered, plain and simple. There is a new video being aired. There was a video being played in the car, and there was one from an aerial shot, I believe it was. They are now synced, and it is clear to tell. It was clear to tell what had happened. The officers can be heard telling him to get on the ground. This is too far ahead. Let me scroll back. Oregon Live is reporting that the FBI agents are now under investigation for possible misconduct. An FBI agent is suspected of lying about firing twice at police or at Robert laVoy Finicum and may have gotten help from four other FBI agents in covering this up. The remarkable disclosure came as a team of local investigators released findings that two state troopers shot Finicum three times in the back. How is this not murder? Under what circumstances can you shoot a person in the back and not have it be murder? Unless that person is actually pointing a gun at another person, perhaps. That is not the case here. The FBI agent didn't report the two shots that he fired, and the FBI didn't indicate why the other four agents were under investigation. How has this not been resolved? Shauna Cox and Victoria Sharp were both eyewitnesses who were riding in the truck that laVoy Finicum was driving when he was shot and killed. This is from a story by Tim Brown. He says, I reported that Cox said that the FBI had her video of what took place and how the recording had been synced with the aerial footage that was released by the DOJ. There is audio, and the video is quite disturbing. It has come out as one FBI agent is being investigated for not reporting two shots taken at Finicum as he exited the vehicle, and four other agents were under investigation. The story the eyewitnesses told seems to be adding up, as there are at least two shots that can be heard as Finicum exits the vehicle and several other shots are fired prior to him leaving the road and plowing into the snowbank, as well as several as they leave the stop. Officers can be heard telling Finicum to get on the ground and he continually yells, you're going to have to shoot me. The video also clearly shows that his hands were up when the first two shots were fired as he exited the vehicle and when the fatal shots were taken. Additionally, you can hear several shots hit the truck following the shooting of Finicum. From all that can be seen and heard, it does not appear to me that any officer's life was in danger at any time. While Finicum does seem ornery, it does not appear that he made any threats, and not getting on the ground is not a reason to kill a man in cold blood when he is not brandishing a weapon. There is just no justification for that. And if someone wants to do that, they would need to do it for every citizen who carries concealed, who has shot someone without a weapon. The FBI and the state police have murdered laVoy Finicum. It is seen on the video. The eyewitness reports are confirming or are being confirmed by what the synced videos show. It is no longer just one person's or just the eyewitness. Eyewitness accounts can sometimes be skewed because they're oftentimes family and friends. And one has to be careful not to take it at face value. Remember the eyewitness accounts for Michael Brown in Missouri. Oh, his hands were in the air. He was saying, don't shoot. In that case, they were lying, and the evidence proved that. In this case, the evidence shows that the eyewitnesses were telling the truth, and laVoy Finicum was murdered by the state and federal officers. Reading from the chat room. Catherine says, an agent shot him. He pointed at the agent and they shot him again. Muriel says, I've watched several different videos. The last one I watched and shared was a short one that another militia person explaining what was going on step by step, showing when the first shot was committed and by whom. The video also showed the agent putting something in laVoy's hand after shooting laVoy twice in the head, close range. They meant to kill him. Also, none of the state police body cam videos had been released yet. And my prediction is they won't ever be released. You're probably right. Also, numerous vehicles in the area had out-of-country license plates, France for one. Seems hired military thugs were in the area. After one report of foreign plates got on the internet, these plates started disappearing with regular plates replacing them. Guess someone said oops and corrected it. That's the first I've heard of the foreign plates. I'm going to have to look into that. Welcome to the chat room, Charlie. Okay, let's see. I've got an icon after Charlie's name, and I can't recall what it is. New member of the chat group. I appreciate you being here, brother. Let me see if I click on this. Charlie Cook, that's it. Charlie Cook, welcome back. Once again, Obama's protected illegal aliens, whom he opens our borders to. Not only do they open... Charlie Coop, pardon me. How did I misread that? I am reading Charlie Cook when I click on his name. Charlie Cook, welcome back, brother. Once again, an illegal alien who has been previously deported has gotten his hands on a weapon, this time an AK-47, and he has murdered 5 Americans. Once again, Obama has blood on his hands for opening our borders, for tying the Border Patrol's hands, for refusing to allow the Border Patrol to do their job. Obama's continually releasing criminal, illegal aliens into the population. Now, this one's never been behind bars, but he has been deported before. And on Wednesday morning, police reportedly found a previously deported Mexican illegal alien, Pablo Antonio Serrano Vitorino, in a puddle of mud armed with a rifle after the suspect reportedly murdered 5 Americans in Missouri. U.S. Customs and Immigration, ICE, appears to have overlooked him. Yeah, overlooked is a good word. Serrano Vitorino is accused of murdering 4 men late Monday night at his neighbor's home in Kansas City. He's also wanted in connection with the shooting death of a 49-year-old Randy Nordman of Montgomery County. I said in a statement late Tuesday that Vitorino was a Mexican national who was in the U.S. illegally, according to authorities. He was held at Overland Park, Kansas Municipal Court on September 14th. The fingerprinting generated an ICE detainer, but the agency erroneously issued the detainer to the Johnson County Sheriff's Office instead of Overland Park Municipal Court. So not only does ICE routinely release these criminal illegal aliens into the community, but they're also criminally incompetent. They get a criminal into their hands and they tell another organization to hold them. The Department of Homeland Security said he was released from custody without ICE being notified, though they did not elaborate as to why. ICE also confirmed that he had been deported back to Mexico in 2004, but had since returned illegally. Serrano Vitorino allegedly murdered his first 4 victims with an AK-47. Nearby schools were put on lockdown thanks to one murderous illegal alien who allegedly didn't let deportation deter him from committing more crimes in America. 5 more deaths attributed to Barack Obama. Meanwhile, police are confiscating guns and a concealed carry permit from a concealed weapons permit holder who believes in Bigfoot, who believes in UFOs, and who believes that the government is out to get him. Police confiscated firearms from 74-year-old Ralph Gilbertson, although he's not a felon, nor a domestic abuser, and he's never been ruled dangerous to others because of mental illness. Gilbertson, who lives in Richfield, Minnesota, believes in Bigfoot and UFOs, and while he does receive treatment for a mild mental health disorder, the Star Tribune reports that a psychologist sent a letter to the judge in the case stating that Gilbertson is compliant with his medications and poses no danger to himself or others. A former Marine, Gilbertson, who is a concealed carry permit holder, which means he has passed the in-depth background check required to obtain such a permit, and he is a proud owner of three handguns until the police knocked on his door. He came to the attention of authorities after individuals at his apartment complex reported that he constantly talks about the government watching him. He particularly voices concerns that the CIA is spying on him. Well, duh. If not the CIA, the NSA. So we got the agency wrong. It's a fact. The government is doing this. You're going to arrest us for talking about it? I know they're listening to me. The Hennepin County Outreach for Psychiatric Emergencies, abbreviated COPE, as a typical government agency is going to do. COPE called the police agency about Gilbertson after his apartment managers expressed concern about a series of letters he had written on CIA spying. How would the office know about these letters to begin with? COPE handles roughly 13,000 cases, only a third of which are face-to-face, and they asked police to escort them to Gilbertson's apartment in 2015. His guns were subsequently confiscated. Richfield Police Department spokesman Lieutenant Mike Flaherty said officers often are forced to make snap judgments about an individual's mental health. The street cops nowadays have to be a psychologist. I say we arrest these sons of bitches for practicing medicine without a license. They have to be a psychologist? Are you kidding me? People don't wear nameplates saying paranoid schizophrenic, so the police have to go in there and make judgment calls. According to Vice, Joseph Olson, emeritus professor at Mitchell Hamlin School of Law in Minnesota, simply sees a man who is eccentric. Olson observes that this is not a crime in America. Gilbertson is suing to get his gun back. An actual psychiatrist has written a letter to the judge stating that Gilbertson is compliant with his medications and poses no danger to himself or others. So why does a cop have to come in and play psychiatrist? Oh, I would love to see this guy get sued for practicing psychiatry without a license. Folks, stick around. We have more coming up after this. We've also got a debate tonight, a GOP debate. Is there never an end to these? Stick around, folks. We'll be right back. Did I say good morning, Charlie? Good morning, Charlie.
Tom O'Halloran.
We'll put a boot in your ass. It's the American way. All brought to you courtesy of the red, white, and blue.
And we are back. This is the Patriot Radio Show, and I am your host, Tom O'Halloran. As I exited to that last commercial break, I said, good morning, Charlie. That wasn't to Charlie Cook, although good morning, Charlie Cook. No, that good morning, Charlie, was to one of my favorite and one of my youngest listeners. and I haven't said good morning to her in a week with all that's been going on politically and stuff. Been kind of rushing into some of these shows because there's been so much to talk about. And now we've got Marco Rubio coming out and apologizing for his behavior. And you know, if it wasn't for his actual policies, for his actually being a progressive, for his actual wanting to open the borders up, for his rudeness to the border patrol and the people committed to securing this country, if it wasn't for that, I like Marco Rubio. I mean, if it wasn't for the facts, he's a nice guy. He talks well. He's got a good attitude. He speaks like a Christian. He talks from the heart, full of hope and promise. Fact is, he is just a liberal. But he was fun to watch. He was fun to listen to. I enjoyed his campaign speeches. But when he turned vile 3 weeks ago and started attacking Donald Trump, attacking his hair, his spray on or whatever tan, attacking him for being a con man, he turned into a vile person. And his poll numbers showed it. I don't think he's got more than a 5 or 8%. I'm sure he hasn't hit double digits in any state since then. Now we're coming up in just a couple of days, less than a week now, the Florida debate, where he's likely to get his ass handed to him in his own state. We're going into another debate tonight. And yesterday he was at a campaign rally and he apologized for his behavior. Megyn Kelly was talking to him. She said, "And you got a little dirty. You got a little naughty." He said, "I'd do it differently. You know I really would." He says, "I don't think it reflects good. That's not who I am." Au contraire, my friend. What you do is who you are. Okay? You usually cover that up some, but you want the brass ring bad enough to put aside your vile side and hide it for the most part. But we saw through that, didn't we? It'll be interesting to see how he behaves tonight in the debate. He's saying, "Yeah, I'd do it differently on the personal stuff. I'm not telling you he didn't deserve it, but that's not who I am. That's not who I want to be." Basically, his kids are ashamed of him, as most Floridians are. In the chat room, we're catching some Rubio might be fun at a picnic, but I wouldn't want him sitting in the right house. Yes, that's Muriel. And getting a thumbs up from Charlie. Catherine says, "So if I disappear and start making a ruckus and disappear, start looking for," yes. Rubio is trying to stay in the race. He's hoping for a brokered convention. Yeah, if it goes to a brokered convention, he's probably going to be the guy. But as you know, if you listened to the show yesterday, I did some numbers. And Donald Trump is likely, not just possible, it's quite likely that he will manage to make the 1237 that he needs. Oh, here's some dirt. Marco Rubio was throwing mud at Donald Trump for Trump University, if you recall. Now, Trump University was a real university. They may not have done all that they had wanted to do and maybe pledged to do, and perhaps some people were unhappy, although most people signed report cards saying that they were happy. There were a few people that weren't, a few people sued. And yes, their Better Business Bureau grade went from A+ down to a D-. It came back up to an A+, and they finally just took the grade off until the lawsuit can be settled. Now, the left and even some on the right are saying there are 5,000 people suing Trump University. There are not 5,000 unhappy people with Trump University. If you get a handful of people, three or four, I don't know what the the floor is, but I believe as few as three or four can start a lawsuit and make it a class action lawsuit. Everybody that is eligible is in that class, whether you sign on or not. So if you sue on behalf of the students, you can have a class action lawsuit of 5,000 people without 5,000 people being unhappy with the organization. Yes, Muriel, if the convention picks Rubio, all hell will break loose. Well, now it is breaking. Bloomberg reported last July, actually, that Florida Senator Marco Rubio's various political operations have accepted $27,000 in contributions from Corinthian colleges. It's a for-profit education chain, much like Donald Trump University. This university has shut down in April of last year. They shut down 11 months ago after a federal investigation found that it had engaged in predatory practices. In its final year, Corinthian had received $1.2 billion in federal student loans. When the U.S. Department of Education last summer slowed down the flow of money to Corinthian because of suspected fraud, Rubio wrote a letter asking the department to demonstrate leniency with the company. This reported by the Miami Herald in April of last year. Bloomberg details how Rubio went to bat for his financial booster, which was taking advantage of Rubio's own constituents. Tweet this out. Google it. You don't have to tweet out my column. You don't have to tweet out my radio show. Google Marco University and Corinthian Colleges. He receives $27,000 from this university, who later gets shut down for taking $1.2 billion in student loans using predatory methods. And then Marco Rubio goes to bat for them, trying to get the Department of Education to ease up and let them keep their money. The top-tier Republican presidential candidate made his plea in a letter obtained by Bloomberg Politics dated June 20th, 2014, and addressed to Jim Shelton, the Deputy Director of Education, and Ted Mitchell, Undersecretary for Post-Secondary Education. Rubio wrote, "It has been brought to my attention that the U.S. Department of Education has recently placed extreme financial constraints on Corinthian colleges by restricting the company's timely access to federal financial aid. While I commend the department's desire to protect our nation's students from fraudulent and malicious activity by any higher education institution, regardless of their tax status, I believe the department can and should demonstrate leniency as long as Corinthian Colleges continues expeditiously and earnestly cooperating by providing documents." He takes $27,000 from this university and then goes to bat. Instead of protecting his constituents, he's protecting his donors. These are the people that are voting for him to be elected. Donald Trump, every time Donald Trump gets booed in a debate, the people in the audience, he says, those are Marco's donors. Those are the people that want him elected. Those are the people that Marco Rubio is protecting. Those are the ones that Marco Rubio represents. It's all about the donor class. It is for Marco Rubio and it is for Ted Cruz. This is why Donald Trump is number one in the polls. Because Americans are tired. Americans are tired of politicians taking $5 and $10 and $20 from Americans, $27,000 from Corinthian University, and going to bat not for the students that are being screwed by the university, but going to bat for the university. This is why Donald Trump is in first place. You want to talk about a con man? You want to talk about a con man, Marco Rubio? You've been conning the constituents in Florida. You are not their representative. You are the representative of Corinthian University. You have turned on the students. You have turned on the students in your district to represent Corinthian University. You, my friend, are the con man, not Donald Trump. Not Donald Trump. It is you. Going into the debate, Fox News has a new poll out. They show John Kasich leading Donald Trump by 5 points in Ohio. Nationally, all the polls combined show Donald Trump ahead by 3. Fox News is so much in the bag for Marco Rubio that they are doing everything possible to give an edge to anybody but Donald Trump. This poll is probably, if you dug into the numbers, if you drilled down to see who they were calling and the questions they were asking, this is probably one of the most corrupt political polls in the history of political polls. Donald Trump is still ahead in every other poll. The national, or the Real Clear Politics poll still has, and that's an average of all the polls. So even if you take this crooked poll, which has Kasich leading by 5, Donald Trump still is up by 5. Recently, we touched on this yesterday. Oh, I don't have time for this. We're at the top of the hour. I do have to exit on my mark because the show is being rebroadcast on a couple of other places, and I have to exit on time. God bless you and yours, America. This is Tom O'Halloran. I'm out.